you. Now, next speaker is our friend from lovely Minsk, Belarus. He is also driving the conference named Rubicon 5, which is pretty good conference, and you must visit it at least once.
Minsk RB? Yes, we do also Minsk RB, and we do it like bimonthly, so yeah. Welcome.
So, welcome Dmitry Zhlobo.
Good morning. Those are my test slides. You are supposed to start your presentation with a question to attendees, because, like, I don't know, it drives encouragement. And so my question is, can you please raise your hand if you know what animal is this? Well, no, not everyone, it's cool. And this is red panda. Yes, it's panda. Sometimes, people don't believe me. They call it a raccoon or something like this, but this is panda. And today is the International Red Panda Day. During this day, everyone who knows about red pandas, they are supposed to tell their friends about red pandas. And the goal is to spread knowledge about those cute animals in order to save them, because they are in danger right now. And so I encourage you to help them if you think they are cute. Or, like, for more information, visit redpanda.org, and yeah, if you feel like, donate them. Yeah, but, well, my presentation is not about red pandas. I'll tell you about growing real subs, and I'll talk about growing. And as you can see, the words in my presentation already grew by vertically. When we need to develop a real sub, we always start, and especially when we start from scratch, we always, like, have a great feeling, because starting something new is simple task. New apps are, like, don't build with very complex features at the beginning. You start with simple, easy steps. Imagine you need to build a forum, like, where people chat. And, well, it probably has, like, posts grouped in topics and organized by categories, right? Four entities, like four models, four controllers. Pretty simple, very nice in the beginning, and your app looks very, very nice, very clean at the very beginning. But time goes, and it becomes more complicated. Your customer comes to you and asks you to bring more complicated features. Users in our forum, users start to have roles. We no longer have general users, but we also have moderators and admins. And we no longer want to remove our posts. We want to archive them so we can have an option to restore them in the future. Then GDPR strikes, and we actually need to remove those posts. Our app becomes, like, more and more complicated. Our features are more complicated. And, well, luckily or not, we have tools in Rails to deal with complexity. We don't want to remove our posts and archive them. Okay, let's like, mark them as removed or archived and use a default scope. We need to send a notification to user when we create a post. Okay, we have callbacks. It's, like, pretty easy. I guess we all agree that using callbacks in models and controllers, using the default scopes, writing the fat models, it will lead us to a very dark place. Our code will become unmaintainable. And the saddest thing here is that if we started to use those wrong tools that Rails encouraged us to use, if we started to use them, it will only emerge. It will become worse and worse, because new developers will come to the project, they will see the patterns, and most likely they will repeat what they see. If they see we use callbacks, they will, well, one more callback, we already have them, so why not to add one more? It will become it will become worse. Luckily, we have better tools to deal with the complexity. And well, we talk about those tools on many meetups, on many conferences. For example, like we don't want to use callbacks. We want to write our like business logic in a separate entity, separate class. And we even have a framework, Trailblazer. I believe you heard about this. We don't like that our models are very complicated. Let's separate queries from actuary models and use RomRB and like many tools, and we have a lot of talks about them. But today I'll tell you about like my favorite things, like how to deal with the complexity the easiest way. Well, not the easiest way, but you know, default way in Rails. And in order to start, I'd like to show you an example of code base of a big code base of one forum. You probably heard about Discourse. Discourse is a like engine for setting up forum. If you need a I don't know, place where you can provide the support to your users, you can set up Discourse, and it's a very great tool. And it's also open source, so we can like review it, investigate it, and learn something from it. And if we download Discourse and start learning it, then take a look at models folder, we can notice that there are 176 files in the models directory. I don't know what you think about it, but like for me, it sounds like a lot. 176. Imagine you're a newcomer and you want to learn about this project, you want to contribute, and you need to like to get familiar, you need to go through those models, and yeah, it's time consuming and it's hard. It's hard to learn. But I believe the problem is not only in the amount of those models, but also in the organization. If we take a closer look at this, at our models in Discourse repository, we can notice that we have, for example, we have a post model, and we have like a lot of other models, for example, like post detail, post revision, and from their name we can guess they are like secondary to the post. They are like depends on post model. And if we open our code of our post model, we can like easily notice, yes, post has many post uploads, has many post details, has many post revisions. And what is even worse, writing code like this encourages us to write it, I don't know, it's not bad way, but like I just don't like it, it's not nice. For example, we need to get details of post, and we always need to repeat this post. Post dot post details, post dot post revisions, post dot post uploads. I just don't like that we repeat this post word. We already know that our object is post. Luckily, there is a way to deal with this, and it's a default functionality of Rails. What I propose to do, I propose to namespace all the secondary models under the like main model, under the post in our case. And it's like it's default namespacing it's default Ruby. We don't need to install any gems, we don't need to do anything. We just put our detail class into the post class. And active record, and with support of Rails auto-loading, it will encourage us to write a nice code. For example, our post no longer has many post details, it has many details. That's how it should sound like. And if it, in a simple case, our namespace post detail will work very well with default has many details association. In a little bit more complex cases, for example, with uploads, we have post upload and we have like global upload model. We will need to specify the class name. Has many uploads, class name, post upload. And that's it. It's like cheap way to organize our models. We don't need to do like anything. Just put our classes in the right place. And what is the best thing of it is that we put our all secondary models under the post directory. And we can not open this directory in the first place when we start to dive into a new project. We see that we have a post model, and we know that post model is not that simple. It has some secondary models, but they are hidden at the very beginning. And yeah, we have some structure in our models now. That's it about models. Let's talk a little bit about controllers. At the same app discards, if we open our controllers, and for example, if we open a user's controller, we can notice that there are more than 1,000 lines of codes. I don't know, if 176 files sounds like maybe okay, but having hundreds of lines of code in having 1,000 lines of code in one file, in one controller, is like definitely not good. And if we open our roles, we want to know why our user's controller is so weak. And if we open our roles, we can notice that our user's controller has a lot of custom actions. For example, as I said, like our application in time becomes like more complex, and we want to have an ability to like ban user or suspend the user and unsuspend it. We want to make the user a moderator and revoke those moderation permissions. And yeah, in Discard app, it's implemented implemented with custom actions in controller. And I've seen it a lot. I've seen those custom actions in many, many, many apps. And yeah, of course, since it's like custom action, it's more methods in our controller, of course it will be like 1,000 lines. I say that we can do better. We can avoid having those custom actions. We can avoid cluttering our controllers. What we need to do is to transform our custom actions to resources. I don't know, it maybe requires some shift of mindset, or what I propose to do is to, for example, we have a suspend and unsuspend custom actions. We can think about it as about resources. What we really do when we suspend user, we create suspension. What we really do when we unsuspend user, we remove suspension. And maybe suspension is not even the right word in English. But, well, we are developers, we can invent words, and we do it a lot of times when we do polymorphic associations. Well, I do. Yes, our paths now will be a little bit different, but I don't know, for me it even looks better. Instead of having suspend and unsuspend variables in our path, we will have a like suspension which is a noun. I like it. And the best thing of it is that we now move two methods from our user's controller to a separate suspensions controller. Our user's controller become smaller, and that's what we want. That's what we want. We want to keep our controllers smaller. But this is not the ideal solution. I still don't really like it because, as you can notice, our user's controller and our suspensions controller are at the same level in the controller's directory. Having them in the controller's directory at the same level may lead to the same problem as we had in models. And luckily, Rails have a feature in Rails roads, very powerful, and we can say that we want to put our suspensions controller into model users, namespace. And yes, we moved our custom actions to separate controllers. Remember, grant moderation and revoke moderations. We now created a moderation permission controller, and yeah, it now lies in a separate directory. And we can see that when we start to learning the app, we can see that we have users controller, and we can see that we have like secondary controllers, probably other actions related to users. But we don't need to dive into them at the very beginning. We may investigate them later. That's it about roads. Oh, that's it about controllers. The next thing I want to talk about is service objects. Sometimes we need to write a lot of code in our actions, in our controllers. And because task is big, task that this action does is big, and we just need to write a lot of code. And sometimes it's like code not only in action, but it also requires creating of separate private methods in controller, and this private method as a description form may need to call another private method. And like our default solution, we learned it already, a lot of talks was about this, is to move this code to a service class, right? We can do it pretty easily. If you move it, just get the code from controller and move it directly to the service class or service object, we won't have like ideal solution. It will work. Okay, it's a little bit better than having a lot of code in controller. Okay, but we can write our service class better. And what I don't like in this service class is that like we have our each method calls private method RSS description form with a parameter post, and then RSS description form method in its turn call info about likes with post with the same parameter, and it's like a waterfall of calls with the same parameter. It doesn't look nice. And this code really looks like it wants us to rewrite it in a different way. For example, here we need to, instead of having those private methods again, we need to extract them in a separate service class. And that is the key thing I want to talk about service objects. I've seen like many times that people are afraid to create separate utility classes such as RSS, POST, POST. And my assumption, or I believe, that people are afraid to create separate classes because they worry about cluttering. And usually you notice it only in Rails apps, because if you write a gem or a library or something like this, I guess you have a different mindset and you are free to create as many classes as you need. But in Rails apps, I don't see it often, and it always ends up having private methods that receive parameters and so on. So, in service classes, my key thing to tell you is that you need to not be afraid of creating new classes. Create them and namespace them. If you namespace them, they are not like, they not clutter our app. For example, we may have a like global post model, but they are not interfere with each other. If we call post in RSS post, autoloading will try, or even autoloading plus like plus Ruby plus lookup will find our RSS post first before the post model. So organize your code. It will look nice, and it's cheap to create new classes. You should not be afraid of doing it. And I believe if you start doing this, creating those small utility classes, which is good, you will have a lot of arguments on a code review. I received a lot of arguments like this. People tend to say that why I need to create a new class? Just for one method? Are you crazy? Are you asking me to move this one method to a separate class? And they sometimes give me a quote of someone famous who say, don't create an abstraction without necessity or something like this. And I used to agree with this, like, okay, one method, which one private method which receives some parameters, maybe it's not that bad, maybe it doesn't look so bad. But I no longer do this, I no longer agree with this, because remember the broken window theory? People, it's not like science or someone studied it, but I believe that people tend to repeat patterns they see in app already. If they see one method, one private method that receives some params, they will add one more private method, and so on and so on. So, I encourage you to create a separate utility class. Not be afraid of creating those utility classes, even if they have only one method. I believe it will be beneficial. And to study it more, I suggest you to check sentiments rules, and it's kind of indicator when you need to split your class. If you write a method that requires you more than 5 lines of code, please split this method. But I found my own rule that I like the most. If you notice that you have a private method that receives argument, may move it to the separate class. Consider creating separate class. Also, I suggest you to read a very good book by Sandy Metz called Practical Object-Oriented Design. It was called in Ruby, but well, it's not only about Ruby, it's about object-oriented programming. Yes, so that was my third thing. And that's basically it. I want to quickly recap. First thing, namespace your model. Make some structure in your model's directory. Second thing, don't create custom actions. Keep your controllers small and maintainable. And third thing, don't be afraid of creating new classes. I hope it didn't sound very obvious, and Yeah, thank you.
We have some time for questions.
I like your approach of organizing controllers in a cloud structure, but we also try to do this, and we face some exceptional situation where you need to create bulk update, bulk create, or something like this, like create a bunch of records in one time. We thought about some workarounds, they're still pretty hacky and ugly, and I wanted to ask you, how do you handle such situation? Maybe you have some of your own patterns how to handle such cases.
I can quickly answer because it was long ago, but I've seen bulk removing of posts in this current code base, and I guess by default, when we write a resourceful role, right, we have a destroy action which relates to a member of resource, and we still need this. I guess it's okay to add a custom actions, custom action, but custom delete action that that applies not to a member, but to the whole resource. Yeah, I would add probably custom action.
So custom method on to action,
yeah? Yes. Okay. So it will be maybe destroy all methods in our controller and in roles it will be like Chris. I don't remember the DSL, but on collection, yeah. Destroy, delete, and destroy all on collection.
Yep. One thing I don't like in your namespacing approach is that you have user namespace for a model and user's namespace for controllers. I suppose it would be better to name it user. It may cause some problems with Rails after loading, but it's more clear, or to extract it into engine.
Yeah, well, I usually create like plural namespace for controllers. Maybe it would be better.
Yeah, and another problem with that approach that you will have users post, for example, or its post will be without the part.
Sorry, don't get it.
So it's for helpers, for rural helpers.
That looks like one of the hardest problems of programming. I don't like naming things, so I sometimes name it like fuck this namespace and just put it that. Oh, surprising!
I actually tried that user controller namespace and I couldn't get it working. If I wanted to have user, colon, and then, for example, the post controller, and I didn't manage to get it done. So have you managed to?
I guess.
Yes, it was a mix of namespace and scope in route.
I spent like one day and then I gave up and then I used users as the namespace, but it was the same problem that I didn't like the
tools. I'm going to show you a piece of code.
I guess it's because when you create a controller, for example, suspensions controller in user namespace, and if Rails reads it first, it creates a user model, module. But then Rails meet class user, and it like, I don't know.
No, it doesn't know the user model anymore when it discovers the controller namespace first. But I didn't have that problem, it was beyond that something. So I was fighting for one day and I gave up. I actually have another question.
Oh, we can wrap it around not with module but with class.
Yes.
And later the module will reopen that class and have your code there.
I hope Rails will reopen it, but
12.
It says that maybe not.
Don't get me started on Rails auto loading. So the question, you said something with when you have a private method that receives arguments, it's wiser to start a new class. So my question is, when you don't want to start a new class, do you use instance variables in that object, and the private method uses the instance variable instead of arguments, or what is the approach?
Yeah, maybe I need to create a separate talk about this, because I usually...
There is one talk free today, so maybe...
Well, maybe like a talk. I tend to not modify our class after we initialized it. And as you remember, there was a loop in one method, and we passed a variable from this loop to a private method. So, like, always resetting this instance variable, it
just... No, of course not, that would be the worst. I was just talking about even without a loop, you know? If you have a... I'm questioning the...
Yes, if without loop, if we can... Without loop, it works well. Like, we set instance variable in initializer, and yeah, we no longer need to pass them in the private method. It's okay. Yes.
What if the instance method, instance variable, is created at some later point or something?
I don't like it. It's okay. Maybe it's okay.
I like to avoid instance variables in general. This is why I usually pass stuff to private methods. But according to Dima's rule, that should be a new class. So if it's a bit more complex on an algorithm, do you have like five classes for that algorithm instead of five private methods, for example?
Let me try to like rephrase it. Usually, when I say about passing a params to a private method, people usually do this in case when a private method is like a helper method, and usually when we have a loop and in another method, that is bad. But like, my idea was to avoid helper private methods and extract them to a separate class. And if we have them in a separate class, we can test them easier.
No, I mean, the general approach is great. That's another question.
I have the pretty simple rule on the private method with parameters. How much times the private methods with arguments called? If it's called once, so we do something wrong. If we have arguments and call it once, if you call this the same method twice, or you use it in the iterator or something like this, I think it's okay. That's
yeah,
all.
But then it's a helper method, and usually I don't test private methods, but they are worth testing. Like in this particular example, RSS description 4 is worth testing. They are kind of helper methods in like for RSS posts, and that's why I encourage you to extract them.
And why don't you have this method on RSS posts? Why do you have this RSS posts in class in first place? Why not RSS post? Why don't this each is a static method, class method on
like
RSS post.
We write it code like this previously. Maybe we write this code differently.
Maybe
but
it's to,
yeah,
it's better to rewrite it appropriately.
Well, maybe. Then it wouldn't be a good example for this presentation. Looks like that's it. We can chat.
Okay, so if we have no questions, so let's discuss this on the coffee break. Coffee break, thanks Dima.
Thank you.